It's the Overdose Talk Show. I had effects on the drums too. Did you hear that? I didn't mean to do that.
Yeah, it sounded really cool.
So tonight, we got a bunch of shit to get to. I'm down here in New Orleans. Andrea and David Box up in Illinois via Skype. We're having a shitty delay.
Hello.
Yeah, see that? We're kind of having shitty delay problems tonight. So if if we don't have our natural and vibrant chemistry, it's because we're hearing each other a second or two behind, whatever. So that's what that's going to be like. So, hey, stay tuned. It's going to be a great show.
Yeah, you're in for a lot of surprises.
Our cousin AJ is supposed to call in tonight, but we don't know him. Never really.
No, we've never talked to him.
No, I met him once when I was a kid. I remember meeting him once, and I thought he looked bad. He was older than me. And he looked
like he looked like a bad guy.
He was like a bad teenager, and I was like, oh shit. This guy's got a backwards hat, and I think he said fuck. But he's so cool. He was probably 13 or 14 or something, and I was probably like 7 or 8. I don't know. That's the only time I've ever met him, but then I've seen him on social networking as we got older. He seemed to be a pretty active sort of anti-police protester and seemed to be involved heavily in certain cases, and then he had his own case that we're going to talk about and stuff where he got arrested for resisting arrest, which I think was one of those ones where they, or what was he arrested for? Failure to disperse.
Yeah.
So whatever, it was a bunch of bullshit and we're going to talk about it. But first, the internet.
Yeah, it was some crazy bullshit.
Yeah, first, the internet is abuzz with talk of this militia up in Oregon taking over a small, what's being called in the media, a federal building. They keep saying that, like, these armed men taking over a federal build. It's like a cabin in the woods, basically.
Yeah.
It's a little bigger, and I think there's some bricks involved. But, I mean, it's not much more.
Technically.
What? Go ahead.
It is a headquarters.
Right. It looks like when.
The headquarters of the Malheur National Park.
Yes. And it looks
so
like.
That would make it federal.
It looks like when you go into a state park or a forest preserve, how you'll see like a ranger building a little house or something there, you know, that's basically what they took over. The whole thing is, of course, you know, it's great for media and stuff to whether they're on the right or the left, to spin whichever way is going to whip their viewers or listeners or followers up into a fervor, and which I think is always the desired thing with most media. But it's surprisingly kind of like quiet in the media, it seems like. And you would think this would be a really this would be a really good one for them to get everybody fighting.
Well, I think it's
whatever.
I think it's a little
we're gonna
too
be talking over each other because of this
point.
Timing thing. Go ahead.
Sorry. I think it's maybe scary because at this point it could get chaotic and become a real citizen stand-up movement. You know, they're not in control of what's happening, so I think it's harder to push it one way or the other because it seems to be genuine and organic, you know?
Yeah. And people are fired up on the internet all over the place. You know, people love to talk about revolution. And, you know, there's a lot of people, keyboard warriors, I guess, but, you know, some of them probably decent people and whatever that are saying, hey, this is it. This is could be the powder keg, you know. And of course, the entire range of people who are supporting it and going, hey, this is dumb. This is just going to demonize the militia movement and blah, blah, blah. But to me, it's like, okay, when, you know, there's always going to be somebody saying you shouldn't at the time that it, when is really the time then to stand up and say, hey, fuck you, you're not pushing us around anymore, and we're fighting back violently if necessary. So if you do believe that time does come, there's always going to be people that's saying it's not time when it is time. You know what I'm trying to say?
Of course.
Let's go into the background on this for anybody who doesn't know. This is it all revolves around the Hammond family, who, you know, if you just look at headlines and you see this and that, you're going to probably make a snap judgment on this whole thing. But if you look at the history here, they've been going through battles with the Bureau of Land Management, which is the same people that were involved with the Clive and Bundy thing, you know, way back when they were all worried that some indigenous turtles were going to be disturbed by his cattle grazing. You know, real concerns from real Americans. They've been fucking around since the 60s in this area. And by the 70s, when I say fucking around, I mean they've been buying up land and trying to basically acquire all the land in this area. And the Hammonds, who this whole thing revolves around, have a pretty they had a huge ranch. I'm not sure if it's still as big as it once was. It was 6,000 acres. And when they purchased it, what happens out there, they also purchase like grazing rights and water rights, which means they have a right to let their cattle graze in public lands and everything else. And they have a right to get to the public water source. It's, you know, something that's given to you when you buy the property, you know? So
right.
The government since the 60s has been like revoking people's grazing permits, and cutting off water rights and restricting access to water to almost everyone in this area to try to get them to sell, to make conditions unbearable so that they'll have to sell their ranches. And the Hammonds are one of like the last holdouts, basically, just to set the scene for you, you know.
Yes.
But they've been doing shit forever, with this idea that cattle grazing is detrimental to wildlife. They've been claiming this for a really long time. And to tell you the truth, I don't fucking know, but it just seems a little silly to me, you know. It's like this is kind of the backbone of the country. The cattle grazers actually settled this area that's in dispute, settled that area like 200 years ago. And that's just always been the culture there. They're just cows eating grass. It's not a huge deal to me. I don't know.
And they've been doing it that way for hundreds of years, and they never needed government intervention before. I mean, there's an ecosystem that stuff builds itself, you know?
It seems like they have some motivation to just acquire the land. Like they...
Right.
A lot of people are saying, they're proposing, you know, that it might be that the BLM has done some kind of surveys and found precious metals, you know, gold and silver and whatever.
Well, that area... I looked into that, and that area is really rich with natural resources like that, gold especially.
Okay. So, I mean, you could see the motivation to get the land,
mm-hmm.
for sure. And these people, a lot of these people, these families around there were like passed down since the land was settled. Like, they didn't go and buy big plot. They fucking settled it back in the time when if you did that, it was yours. So, you know, the government doesn't like that shit. Like, hold on, you've had this for six generations? Fuck you.
No.
We are going to need to collect at this point. So so they'll make it unbearable for the people around there. They'll block roads. And they established that wildlife refuge that basically surrounds the whole Hammond Ranch now. The Malheur, whatever, National Malheur Wildlife Refuge. And... that's where the militia now has taken over the cabin.
the government building.
Yeah. It is, I don't know. These things always start a little bit funny, but we'll see what happens.
They do, but you know what? Like, someone has to be the first people to do it, and they got a lot of attention. First they said there was going to be 150 of them there. Current estimates put them more in the 12 to 18 range.
Yeah, I know. But they're
doing it.
They're putting out videos going, hey, come join us. They're saying, the militia is saying they're going to stay there for years, potentially.
They said they're prepared to stay there forever.
Right. So
years, absolutely.
What I'm trying to put into perspective here is there is a pretty clear history of bullshit that's been going on. And the government does want everybody off this land, and the Hammonds have refused to sell. They actually, things got so bad for them that they sold the ranch at one point, but kept it out of the BLM's hands. They sold it to another rancher who, you know, they knew, who wouldn't make a deal with the BLM. So when he died, his family basically just traded back ranches with the Hammonds, and they got back to their original ranch. and had saved up some cash and whatever. So then when they got back there is when all this shit started happening, where now they're accused of starting two fires on federal land, which is another thing. It's like, why is that supposed to have some kind of weight to federal land? It's just land. What are you talking about?
There's nothing out there.
Not doing anything.
What kind of fires? Like campfires?
No.
There were fires to control other fires that threatened their land.
Well, no, I think the first one was legitimately an accident. They were trying to do like a controlled burn on their land, and it accidentally spread onto federal land, but they put it out themselves, and nothing really came of it at the time. But
the whole thing is based on the fact that they have an agreement with the government and the BLM that they will work together to manage the land to make it habitable.
Sure.
So even if they did have a controlling fire on federal land, that would still be within their agreement.
And
right?
Still, they act like, now the rumor I've heard too is like they were illegally deer hunting and they burned the woods down to cover up the evidence. Like, that is a claim that could only be made by somebody who's never, ever been around, you know, like rural people. You know what I mean? Like that is just such a ridiculous. And never been around hunters, never been around, you know, people with guns and that kind of side of society and that side of this country. Can you imagine, you know, like ranchers illegally hunting deer and then thinking like, well, how are we going to fucking get out of this, man? You know, like we got is they're gonna
we'll fry for this.
Yeah, we're gonna burn down. They burned down 127 acres of woods. So what people are proposing is like, yeah, to cover up a few blood stains, that we would have to burn down 127 acres of woods. Whatever. That sounded silly to me too. So then, in 2006, there was a huge lightning storm, and that's when they did the controlled burn. That they were like, you know, hey, the fire was encroaching on our ranch. We had to do something. Nobody else was here. The BLM firefighters weren't here. We needed to stop the fire. You know, that's how they do it. So they did that, and then that's what they ended up getting charged for. And originally, charges were dropped, which is the weird thing. They've been dealing with this since 2006 because they basically, they did what's called a backburn, or what is it? Backfire, backburn, some shit. To stop a wildfire, which worked, by the way.
So
then they heard nothing about it until 2011, when the U.S. Attorney Office charges them with arson and terrorism based on the Federal Anti-Terrorism Act of 1996, which, by the way, not like this is realistically going to happen, they could be given the death penalty. But it's a minimum of 5 years.
They made that law for because of Timothy McVeigh was okay. One of the biggest reasons why that law was created, for, you know, harsher penalties for inflicting things on federal land and buildings.
Yeah, well, he did that whole thing all by himself.
Yeah, of course
he
did.
We know that. Nothing suspicious there.
He was a nut job.
He wasn't photographed in them working on a military base 8 years after he was supposedly out of the military, whatever.
Yeah.
Side note, whatever. Okay, so what ends up happening is Stephen and Dwight Hammond, the ranchers who did the controlled burns, end up in court again. And the judge goes, all right, we're not even going to give you the minimum sentence. We're going to give the son a year. And the son, he's what, in his 40s, I think. And the dad,
46.
Yeah, and we're giving the dad 3 months because he's 70-ish.
73.
Yeah, so they do their time. They're like, all right, guess we gotta. They go to prison. These two ranchers go to prison, and they get out, and they're out for whatever, a couple years. And these two people, Rhonda something, and I couldn't understand the name. I've heard it on people say it on the news a few times. It's like Carge or Karch or something. Rhonda and Chad, whoever. And she's a field manager for the BLM, and he's a refuge manager at the Malheur Wildlife Refuge. So these two go as like independent citizens and file an appeal, which you say we've talked about this before. I didn't remember this. I didn't feel like I knew that you could do this, is like file an appeal to an appeals court and say these people didn't serve enough time or they weren't given a harsh enough sentence. And here's why. And so the Ninth Circuit Court or whatever in Oregon goes, okay, you're right. We are going to go get them and make them go back to prison.
Oh my God.
So they come get them, or they went back to court on it and whatever. They're resentenced, and now they have to go back and serve the remainder. So the guy that's 73 now, because of a controlled burn to stop a wildfire 10 years ago, is going to go to prison for 4 years and 9 months.
Yeah.
Pretty much a death sentence. Yeah. Maybe not.
Or a life sentence.
Yeah. I mean, it's close to it, if not. And as another term, when they were resentenced, now the Bureau of Land Management has first... I forget what the name of it is, but they basically filed a thing that says they have first access to if they want to sell the Hammond Ranch, that they can't sell it to anyone else.
They call dibs.
That, yeah, BLM has dibs. Is that fucking ridiculous or what? So you can see,
yeah,
whatever your views are on militias and gun people, and you know, there's a lot of people playing the racial thing with this about, like, and they might have a point to a certain degree. I don't know. We could flush it out a little, but the racial privilege of going, hey, if a bunch of black guys took over some building in the woods, this would be a huge deal, and a lot of people would be way up in arms about it. But it just depends on how the media reports it in the end. So if it happened and no one knew about it like this, they might not be. I don't know. They might have a point with that. What do you think?
That's really the only side of it that I've seen on like my Facebook news feed and everything else that like just pops up.
Yeah.
Like I've only seen that racial angle. Like
that's what most people are going with here.
Yeah.
If this is Ferguson, they sent the Coast Guard, and this will, like, yeah, Ferguson, like it or not, turned into a melee that just went into total chaos. I mean, so yeah, they're coming. This, so far, no one's done anything. I don't even think a window's been broken yet. So it's like, it's kind of a weird comparison. And plus,
well,
go ahead.
If it's just 13 dudes piling in a cabin, you know, nobody got shot or killed yet, so maybe that's why.
And plus, this is something that's organic, like Andrea said, and being done by real people who are independently organizing it. Ferguson and the Baltimore riots and shit, that all had marks of provocateuring all over it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, that shit was all set up to be a fucking shit show. They call the protesters are rioting. Well, then, hang on. How come they're not rioters? Because, like, yeah. I know there were people over there holding signs, and then there were people over here kicking in windows and stealing TVs. Why are they connected? It was just this obvious ploy to get everything all fucking riled up, you know, and get everybody pissed off and wasting time and whatever. But, so anyways, this is a real thing that they can't really control. So, I don't know, whatever. To me, it's a worthless comparison. But anyways, that's what most people are going with here, is the easy kind of racial bickering kind of stuff, I guess.
Of course. That's what most people usually go with.
But not the Overdose talk show.
I've seen these guys described as a weird combination of, like, tinfoil wearing government haters and also rednecks.
Yeah.
That's kind of the picture that I'm getting in my head.
Well, they're all all the videos of the militia guys at the thing have seen or have looked like military. They look like it. I don't know if they are. Probably some of them are former military, but they're dressed that way, you know.
Oh, and you know what? We haven't mentioned this yet, I don't think, but people have come. This group of militants came from all over the country. They're not just all from the area either.
Yeah.
People traveled from other states, as far as Idaho, Texas, Arizona, New Mexico. People traveled from pretty far away to get to what's happening right now. So,
yeah, 12 of them.
Yeah.
I don't know, dude. We'll see how it plays out. I think I for some reason, I see a missed call on the Skype, but it didn't pop up on my screen. Tell
have
AJ
the feds
if,
made
if he called
any
to call back.
At all, or is it just...
No, they haven't done anything, but this has only been going on since yesterday. And they're supposed to go to jail tomorrow, and no one knows what's going to happen.
Oh, so this is like...
They were ordered to report to prison by tomorrow. The
this
Hammonds.
This is happening now.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, I actually
this is
just
breaking
got,
news, David Box.
I just got an update right now. Allegedly, the FBI... has arrived in Oregon, preparing to gain tactical advantage over militia with swift, hot response effort. So I guess the FBI is getting into
those
it.
Those are quick, pretty words for them, just like
right.
sending an army.
Yeah.
So they're going to do what? They're going to have a quick, hot response?
Yeah, use finesse.
Is that but is hot in like tactical language? Does that mean they're gonna fucking go in blazing?
Here's what I've got: heavily armed and well equipped federal agents have arrived in Oregon in from various parts of the U.S. to gain tactical advantage over the armed Patriot group who commandeered a federal building Saturday by responding swiftly and with force if necessary.
Hmm.
Yeah, dude. Well, this is going to be fucked up.
I wonder what our political candidates will say about this.
The Harney County Sheriff said these men came to Harney County claiming to be part of militia groups supporting local ranchers, when in reality these men had alternative motives to attempt to overthrow the county and federal government in hopes to spark a movement across the United States.
Well,
oh,
yeah,
selling it like it is.
I mean, these people are there going, look, there's nothing legitimate about what's happening. They're trying to fucking steal land. Where does it stop? And that's basically what they're saying is like we're prepared to dig in. We're not going anywhere. This has to stop somewhere. But they haven't clearly said we're going to protect you from taking these two to prison. You know,
right?
That's what I don't get about it, because they first had a protest. And then just marched over and took this building. It's basically all we know.
Yeah. Well, and some of them are claiming that they tried to recruit people at the protest. Some people are claiming that everybody knew what was going to happen. Some people are claiming they hadn't heard anything about it. But Hammond Bundy.
Yeah,
thank you. Officially said, like, we've planned this for a really long time. This was not a last-minute decision. So there was some group at work for a long time before this happened. But they couldn't recruit a single person, like, just in the moment to do it with them when they got there, which I thought was kind of weird.
They couldn't recruit a single person to do what?
To join them. The people who are there now had organized ahead of time and came from all over the country to do this thing together.
Oh, okay.
And when they got there and they went to the big protest, more people to join them, and apparently they completely failed.
I see. Yeah, because...
Yeah.
Dude, if I was at a protest and people I didn't know were like, hey, dude, we got the guns. We're going out to the middle of the woods. Like, are you in or what? I'd be like,
yeah.
I don't know. Because...
I have to go to... Tomorrow.
Yeah, I had plans. I was gonna go look at this record collection that I might buy. I don't know.
I already rescheduled with this guy like 3 times.
And plus, I've seen at protests with my own 2 eyes, I've seen people that had to be some weird fucking provocateur group just trying to, you know, get a fight going with the cops and stuff, and go and like handing out black bandanas and being like, do you want to join the black bloc? Come on in. Here's what you got. And like getting all these college kids all hyped up and stuff and basically just trying to stage the fight for the cameras that everybody wants to see, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I've seen it myself. Just like, so if I'm at a protest and you're like, dude, we're seriously like, come on, let's go. I'm like, you could have called me earlier. I could have come to a few of the meetings and seen what you're about and stuff. I don't know, man.
Yeah.
Do you have like a business card or anything?
So I'm not surprised that nobody went.
I left my good gun at home for this protest.
So, up to the minute report is that the FBI is on the scene, huh?
Yeah, that's what I'm hearing, although I'm only getting that from one source, so it might not be true.
Who's
however,
it from?
IntelliHub.
They're spotty. And I
think there's sometimes, but they do get stuff early, so
yeah.
When they have it, so I'm trying to confirm now, but
I think they were the ones that posted that fucking like pro police thing that was all talking shit about Samuel L. Jackson for criticizing police.
Oh, did they talk shit about that?
I thought it was them. Oh no, it's Breitbart. Sorry.
Oh, okay.
They might have shared it on Facebook or something, that's why I got confused. I don't know. But yeah, they're pissed. A lot of people are really pissed off about Samuel L. Jackson.
I didn't think that anything he said was super unreasonable.
It's completely logical. He's basically talking about how guys come back from the war and a lot of them become cops and they, you know, he goes into the PTSD thing, but he also says, you know, you've got people, here's the quote, you've got people out there who are used to looking at people as, quote, the enemy, because that's what it was. People were trying to kill them every day. It was like, oh my God, you see a guy, the guy jumps up, hold it, young black men are threatening, you know, and it just happens. So all these things snowball and snowball. And I don't see anything weird about that at all. Like, that's actually a pretty good...
No.
That's a pretty fucking good point. Like, look, these people have been in combat, and then we make them police officers, and their mindset is that they're dealing with the enemy, you know? And that fits my experience with a lot of police cops.
Sounds like it's just a common knowledge thing. It sounds like something everybody already knows.
Yeah, exactly. And everybody's all pissed off at him. Breitbart says, wait, what did they say? There is a more rancid and unfair smear. Oh, if there is a more rancid and unfair smear of America's veterans than the one that paints them as damaged and dangerous PTSD sufferers we should all fear, I have yet to hear it. John Nolte. Did you really start your article with an I have yet to hear it? You fucking hack. Nevertheless, in an interview with the Hollywood Reporter, Hateful Eight star Samuel L. Jackson not only raised this grossly unfair stereotype, with no evidence to back it up, he argues that these heroes of Iraq and Afghanistan enter the police force and become dangerous cops.
I'm sorry, no evidence to back it up?
Mm.
How about the fact that most ex-military become police officers, and that it's just well known that all of the Vietnam vets were treated poorly and alienated. Like, it's...
Oh, we didn't even read that part of the quote, but yeah, he said that too.
Oh, yeah. And that was helped contribute to the divide, that they, you know, that police forces were targeting people who were already alienated from the societies that they were existing in.
Yeah, and if you've been in foreign lands killing folks, it might have a little bit of a strange effect on the old mind-a-rooney. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah. Especially, like, just wandering through villages and burning down houses.
Yeah. So, old Samuel L. Jackson, up to his old anti-police tricks.
Celebrities out there who poured ice water on your head, here's a chance to do something else.
Actor Samuel L. Jackson posting a video to his Facebook challenging celebrities to sing what's becoming the anthem of the anti-police brutality movement. It's being called the...
Samuel L. Jackson has gotten very uppity from his Hollywood... whoops, I can't... Oh, sorry.
I can't breathe challenge.
I can hear my neighbor crying. I can't breathe. Now I'm in the struggle.
Even though how much I hate police, I can't stand that he did this.
No.
This is fucking cheesy.
There's
like,
so many better ways.
Yeah.
A lot of people on YouTube did do this thing.
Oh my God, I was so shocked. There are
no
so many videos.
Though.
But like, we watched one of like a like a big fat white guy who looked kind of like a Jewier version of Jonah Hill.
I think he was trying to be Elvis.
Elvis?
I think he was an Elvis impersonator.
I don't know.
His thing what said what's the song called?
I Can't Breathe.
I Can't Breathe by The King is what it was.
Whatever. I'm just amazed at how many people participated in this.
But yeah.
Stupid song, you mean?
Yeah.
Sam Jackson chiming in on the black thing.
Samuel L. Jackson proving he hasn't forgotten where he's from. Assuming he's from the streets, because that's where black people are from, I think. Tonight at 9. I'm a news guy. I've never been outside before. I was actually grown in a pod on this swiveling chair.
You know, the cops made all of those threats. Well, they made like some vague threats towards Quentin Tarantino about the release of this movie, and then nothing ever happened, or?
Well, I'll tell you why, young Andrea. As you go through life, you'll find that pro-police support and organization of police supporters is quite lacking in this country, because it's mostly made up of police, their wives, children, and possibly extends to like brother-in-laws and shit like that, who are like dumbass, ultra conservatives. So you don't have many people that like police in this country enough to actually support them in any visible way, you know. And
you're like super rich.
Well, you know what? I don't remember what I asked, but I can't believe I didn't get this article.
I feel like I didn't get to the answer yet, and I was just setting it up.
All right, wait. You reminded me, though. We have to mention this. Cop Block came out this last week and admitted that they had set up a fake Facebook page called Civilians Against Cop Block, and they were using it as a social experiment, and they were just like sharing completely wrong, quote-unquote, facts, and like just watching how people support and defend the things that they were making up. How pro-police people would just like blindly support and defend anything, any claim that they made in the pro-police realm.
I remember what I was...
It's great.
I remember what I was rambling to before. It's that the reason nothing came of that is I was laughing at the time. They were like, we're going to have a boycott of this movie because of Quentin Tarantino's anti-police statements. And it's like, who... Do you know what a tiny number of people it is that give enough of a fuck about police... that boycott scares no one. The police boycott has zero power. Nobody cares. That's where I was going with that before. Anyways, that would not affect the numbers of a major motion picture, I wouldn't think, young Andrea.
Yeah, I suppose that's a good point, sir.
If anything, that's going to draw more people to go see the movie.
So what were you saying? Oh, let's wrap up what you were doing, because the phones are lit. Man alive.
Whoa. no, I'll find the article to share with people here, but Cop Block had set up a fake pro-police page and basically found throughout the experiment that pro-police citizens will just blindly support anything, whether it's made up or not. As long as it's pro-police.
You could probably say the same about a lot of anti-police people, too, though.
I don't know why, but I feel like the anti-police crowd is probably more seasoned in fact-checking, because they tend to lean towards the alternative ideas.
Well, that's kind of how you get to be as sort of vigilant as to even call yourself just blanketly like anti-police, is you get into the topic and you learn more and more. And then you go, holy fuck, these people are evil. You know, like that's generally how you come to that conclusion, is you do a whole bunch of research. So, yeah, on the other side, you just go, whoa, my dad's a cop. He's not bad.
Yeah.
And that's basically all you got.
Well, I think bad cops should be held accountable, but.
I know cops and they're cool. Yeah, to you. Because you know them. It's kind of the whole point is they have the power to be discriminate in their enforcement of laws. Anyways, let's try out the phone. We haven't used it in a while. Haven't had anything going on. Our cousin AJ, he's in California, right? Andrea, give him a nice introduction before we bring him on.
Oh, all right. Our cousin AJ is in Fullerton, I believe, but has recently beaten a case for failure to disperse, for which he was charged 3 months after he had allegedly failed to disperse from a protest. He is a citizen journalist and an active.
They had detectives roaming the streets just looking for him, just to try to make sure he went home.
They sent.
I'm just saying he wasted a lot of resources by not dispersing fully within their view, so that they could confirm his disbursement.
I'm glad you said that, though, because I do want to mention.
You know, that's taxpayer money, Andrea.
The Fullerton Police Department ordered 6 police officers in 3 vehicles to travel 35 miles to Pasadena from Fullerton to arrest him 3 months after he failed to disperse.
Okay, that's a good enough intro, I guess. Hello, AJ.
Hey, how's it going, cuz?
Hey, what's up, man? How you doing?
Chilling. How are you?
Great. So yeah, we're working with a little delay tonight. So if we talk over each other a little bit, we'll just try to, we'll try to amend as we go. You got your case dismissed. First of all, congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It was a long, drawn out process. I was getting harassed, but we beat it. I got a good lawyer.
How long did it take?
It was, well, they tried to have a second jury trial. The first jury trial was a hung jury, and then the DA did something very crazy, which was try to have a second trial with me over a misdemeanor, and I had a co-defendant, and it was just unheard of. And the judge had a little side talk with him, and he offered me one more deal. He was like, all right. I'll pretty much suck your dick and just plead to the charges.
Right.
And they're like, fuck you, not guilty. And then the judge was like, if they stay out of trouble for 6 months in Orange County, I'm going to be forced to dismiss these charges.
And so that's all you had to do?
Pretty easy to stay out of trouble.
Yes, I could do 6 months standing on my head.
No, it's California. Marijuana is legal. Doing anything crazy. But in those 6 months, you know, it's kind of put a little damper on my journalistic abilities to do what I like to do, which is film the police. So,
right,
I mean,
okay.
It kind of took its toll.
How did this,
I don't want to get into that.
How did this whole thing start? You were at what kind of protest, and what was the whole scene there?
Well, I don't know how much time. Do we have a lot of time? You know, I mean, the long version?
We don't really care. We have no format.
Perfect. It all started when I was 3 years old.
Right.
I don't know why I use humor in awkward situations, uncomfortable situations, because what I'm about to talk about is very uncomfortable. But Kelly Thomas was a homeless transient who was had a mental disability, pretty infamous in the where he stayed at in the Fullerton Transit bus depot, and just everybody knew him there as being, you know, cool Kelly. He had good days, he had bad days, but he was harmless.
Right.
And
yeah, we know the Kelly Thomas case really well. We did it on the show a bunch of times, and we kept up with it. But yeah, give us the quick overview of it for anybody who doesn't.
So they fucking, the waitress called the cops on him because they were pretty much tired of him fucking with their customers, asking for cigarettes or whatnot. Mm-hmm. And so they called the cops, kind of like misled to him having a weapon. And then the cops showed up, and Ramos and killed him. Wolf 2 and three other officers showed up on there that are still employed and got raises and shit. And
right.
So anyways, we're having a protest because Cincinnati's trying to get his job back. Cincinnati's one of the cops, and he's trying to sue to get his job back. So we have a public awareness gathering. I say we. I'm just being the press, I guess. Not leading anything, that's for sure. But the day proceeds. It's a very peaceful event. There's some like outburst. The crowd pretty much controls itself, stops every outburst, from cleans up its own graffiti. You know, we're taking care of ourselves. We're just trying to get the point out there. We have a couple bad apples. We take care of them. Well, it's getting later and later. They're had enough of it. They bring out the cops, fucking tons of cops. My first time really seeing this many cops in riot gear all up close and personal. I mean, I have seen them at the Washington, when I was at the Republican National Convention and the Democratic Convention. They lined up like stormtroopers out there. But this is different because it's like these were normal police officers all of a sudden all rioted out. I was like,
yeah, it's fucked.
Crazy.
It's really fucked up when you're close up to them. We did the NATO protest in Chicago, and Andrea, what do you think it was like? Fucking 3 miles of street lined with riot cops, shoulder to shoulder. It was like completely.
Yeah, they were
insane.
literally standing 2 to 3 feet apart.
That was the creepiest day of my life, actually, looking back on it.
Yeah, that was terrifying.
They were like robots.
Oh yeah, David Box was there too. That's right.
Yeah, and they actually had tags with barcodes on them.
Did they really?
They actually did. No, so, and like they all had those sunglasses where you couldn't see their eyes, and they, you know,
yeah,
they looked like fucking robots.
And then when it was time to fight for the 9 o'clock news, they all ran up and had that big like pushing fight with the protesters that never looks like anything's actually happening. Just everybody like pushing back and forth in a mob. But anyways, back to AJ's story.
Back to the West Coast. So I was just pretty much using humor because it was hilarious to me, and I'm just talking shit this whole time. I'm live streaming, Ustreaming. Actually, I have a Ustream channel with In League Press.
Okay.
INLEG. Anyway, suck it. So the cops are getting pissed. Like more, they're starting to come after me at this point, like targeting me, and I'm like, I know I'm not doing anything illegal. I'm staying on this side of the boundary where they're telling me to stay. You know, I'm not fucking, you know, I'm just fucking with them with words. I'm not like intimidating them. I'm just talking about what's going on, and just every time they move, I move.
Yeah.
Well, they've had enough of it because I have thousands of viewers now that have watched this military police take action, and they're watching on their cameras inside of the, on their computers inside of the police station that we found out during the trial. So they're watching it live. And so the very end of the live stream is pretty much me saying, oh, it looks like they're leading my parade because everybody else is dispersed. It's just me, the fucking stupid armored assault vehicle, Humvee thing, and a bunch of cops. And these two cops, and actually I'm saying two cars of cops, come flying around the corner, and I disperse like the motherfucking wind.
Yeah.
Hopping over, I break their ankles. There's a few weekly takes these awesome photographs of me. It's pretty unreal, and I live streamed the whole event. And I can now pretty much talk about it because this is my first actually time ever talking about it because it's been looking at 6 months of jail for some bullshit.
Yeah, dude. Well, and they sometimes like to, you know, they'll take somebody and make an example out of them in some protest movement. And it's like, eventually there's nothing you can do. I mean, we've seen so many cases where people are just had ridiculous charges brought against them that they can't get out of. And, you know, their friends don't all grab rifles and go down and break them out of jail. You really go to jail, you know? It's like, it's a very real thing when you're protesting against police. They've done a lot of horrible stuff to people.
Can I just say that I have awesome friends, and they did the next best thing, which was call the jail every 7 seconds. Hey. Sorry, hold on a second.
Right.
Bonnie's right here.
little dog right, problem.
Yeah, I got Playboy bunnies all around this place. You know, we roll. Joking, man. Like, it's a real bunny and like seven dogs. That's how I roll. Five chickens. Cali.
That sounds fun.
So
I love that.
Yeah, you know, it's fresh. Keeping it fresh. So my friends are calling every, like, they're blowing this phone up. I'm singing show tunes in the holding cell. I'm just driving them nuts with this illegal arrest. So I hope one day to get all that footage. We've requested it.
Yeah, dude, I've got a case coming up too that once it's all over, I'm going to Freedom of Information Act, try to request my footage from the police station. Because I was just a complete belligerent fucking maniac when I was being the entire processing time. And I'm trying to get
I think we should have, that runs in the family, obviously. We should have a contest, put them side by side. I think they're probably pretty similar.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure.
And let's
do it on the show.
Speaking of which,
for sure.
I think that you and I have only met once, and I think I was like 7 or 8, and I think you were like 13, 14-ish, something like that. And I was I was like, hey, this guy looks kind of bad. I was like, he looks like a bad like teenager, like in like some kind of troublemaking kid. I was like, I think you might have a backwards hat on or something.
Right, and a tan.
Yeah, and a tan, yeah. And, but I think that's the only time we've ever met, on Easter in 1992.
Yeah, it's too bad. It's too bad. I've been following your shit for now for a while. Your robot hilarious stuff is fucking hilarious.
Oh, cool.
So
yeah, thank you.
It's too bad. I wish we teamed up on some projects a little bit earlier on, but we're here now. So
yeah, that's cool.
2016.
Speaking of which, do you have that all the footage from you running from the cops at the protest and all that? Is that on YouTube anywhere?
Oh yeah. That's all over YouTube.
What do people look up?
Our press page is In League Press, InLeague Press, .com. We have that website. But you could Google Anaheim James. That's my journalist name, journalistic name. And there's pictures for days.
Cool. In League Press and Anaheim James, right?
Right.
Okay, cool. I almost said Analog James, but that Kelly Thomas case, the Kelly Thomas case was really fucked up. Andrea, you remember that, right? That's where
Of course.
When they were beating the guy to death, and he was screaming for his parents, I think, and you know, they just were mercilessly beating him. It was that kind of stuff is you know, we see tons of police brutality videos constantly. But that kind of shit is even pretty rare, where they just don't stop, you know, and it's like, holy shit. No one was charged with a crime in that, huh?
Well, they were found not guilty.
No, they were charged.
Oh, they were charged, but they were found not guilty. Yeah, well, hey, you look at the video, and I'm sure the prosecutor and the DA and whoever says, you know, well, you can't really tell from the video exactly what's happening, and you can't see what he's doing, and they were in fear of their lives because they were told he had a weapon. It's just so fucking ridiculous, right in front of your face, just complete corruption.
That case, yeah, definitely.
Go ahead, we're just dealing with this stupid delay. Everybody's nervous to talk over each other now. But what were you saying, Andrea?
That case, I noticed. That case made like a measurable shift in the way people were thinking about police and holding police accountable. I could like see it happening where that was like a catalyst for people to start coming to the other side, you know?
Yeah.
That one was, it was like so horrific and so over the top that it was hard to ignore.
So, and if you don't grow up hating police for some reason, it takes like a really giant event to shift your thinking on it, it seems like.
Yeah.
But we all grew up hating police, so that wasn't really a problem.
Yeah. Shout out to NWA.
Yeah. Shout out to a dad who gets arrested once in a while and teaches you how to hate police.
what?
My dad. Yeah.
So
well, we have family members that are police officers. I don't even know if you know that. I'm not going to go into detail about that. But we have also a lot. I personally have good family friends that are police officers. So I don't hate all cops, but in the same way that all cops are bastards, because they wake up every fucking day and do their same fucking job with their same corrupt partner and don't say shit.
Yeah. And the main thing, the way we always break it down is like, yeah, we play around emotionally. We hate cops just because of our individual experiences. But when you break it down logically, you know, to be a cop is to commit immoral acts every day, you know? So it's just an immoral thing to do to be a cop. It's just a bad thing to do. So it's like, even if the person might be good in their private life and think that they're in there for the right reasons, they're still a fucking piece of shit in a way, you know? and that's kind of the view that we have on the show.
I'm still going to give them an out every time. I'm like, unless they're like taking digital notes and making photocopies and recording stuff and leaking stuff and becoming whistleblowers, then I have to agree with you 100%.
All right. Well, I guess if they're a spy, that's all right.
All right. Putting thoughts of people says there, maybe. Come on, guys. Keep them coming. Keep those secrets coming.
Yeah, so you
some shit.
You were saying, too, that the gas leak is being covered up by the media. There's this gas leak going on in California.
Oh, yeah. I saw what you said on Facebook earlier about your posts regarding the California gas leak. We're, like, getting erased from Facebook?
Well, it wouldn't be the first time that my posts have been censored, for sure. I'm sure that happens to a lot of people, especially when you post about real shit. But especially out here in the situation where we're maybe in a position, maybe we can huddle up and do something about it, maybe get some information, go there, because we're right next door. Maybe that's why. But I think it just kind of makes it a little bit more fuel for my fire.
So this is tons of methane, too, leaking out, which I would think, you know, like I said, we always kind of look for things that aren't being reported on in the media that the media should be all over, because this is a great one for the global warming angle and all this stuff that the media loves to do. Why aren't they doing it? Why are we hearing nothing about it?
Right.
Andrea?
It's I can't tell you why we're hearing nothing about it. Even David Box, you didn't even hear about this until today either, right?
No, this is my I'm learning.
It's bad enough worse. That they declared a no-fly zone over it.
They have evacuated thousands of people. This is the damage as of right now is worse than the Deepwater Horizon oil spill. The BP oil spill in the Gulf of Mexico. There is currently 70,000 pounds of methane gas being released every hour.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
Yeah, that sounds pretty bad. There's a
horrific infrared video. Let's see, a specialized infrared camera operated by a certified thermographer, where they actually captured video of the leak happening, because it's invisible. Obviously, it's gas, but it's terrifying.
AJ's on the ground there in California. AJ, what are you seeing on the gas leak? What do you know?
Well, pretty much just like you, I haven't really put that much effort as far as getting more information than what's been out there in the news, and I don't know if I could. It looks like they've done a pretty good job with that video of getting information out there. Now they have came out public saying that it's not going to be fixed until possibly March. Well, we know what they said about the Gulf still. You know, they're like, oh, yeah, we fixed that yesterday.
Dude, and that whole thing was so suspicious all the way through. I am of the mindset that was done purposely. But that's a whole other thing. Just a quick thing on it though. They knew where they were drilling was really unstable. They had just done tests right next to it very recently. And, they decided to go ahead with it anyways by getting a permit from some other government agency that than the one who had just rejected them. And they drilled nearby, and right before they did it, Halliburton bought this oil cleanup company called Boots and Coots. How many times have I done this on the show? I love explaining this, though. It's so suspicious. And they bought this cleanup company that got the contract after the spill happened and made millions and millions of dollars and shit. Plus, they got to introduce this synthetic organism called Cynthia that they think might have, mm-hmm. like, mimicking capabilities and be able to take in DNA and, mutate itself and try to reform whatever kind of biological material it comes in contact with, like a blobby kind of thing. Whatever. Go look it up, everybody, on YouTube. There's a shitload of people who are still actually YouTube making videos about that on YouTube and the Black Plague. The Blue Plague, sorry. Whatever. I didn't mean to go on that for that long. I'm such a douchebag with that.
Have you?
Anytime anybody brings that up, I'm like, all right, sit down.
Well, it's worse. It's worse than that, is what they're saying.
Yeah, the damage caused is worse. And their plan to fix it is they are drilling 100 feet through through rock, basically, to try to hit a 7-inch pipe 100 feet under the surface to create like a reserve well.
Hey, my girlfriend's only got to undo a zipper for a 7-inch pipe. You know what I mean? hundred feet of rock. I don't think she'd go for that. You know what I mean, guys?
Hey.
Anyways.
You know,
I mean, it takes a six-pack to get her to original... to drop a zipper. What's it going to take to go through?
Yeah, we got it.
All right, so I found the original article from the day that this happened, and they had planned to have it fixed in 2 days. They said this problem should be fixed in by Saturday, which would have been
You know what they said? They were like, here's what we're going to do. We're going to find the leak, and get this, we're going to stuff mud and brine in there. Stop it right up. So they go, couldn't do that because of the immense pressure. Like, well, who was working on this? Wouldn't have engineers have fucking known that? What, that was your solution?
Yeah.
Like, so like, and there was ice forming around it.
Something.
Yeah. So the mud and brine just blew out. And then since then they've kind of been going, I don't know. And their plan is to go down like a mile. They got to drill down and they're digging like another pipe to reroute the gas, I think, is basically mm-hmm. what's going on. They're going to put in like an elbow joint and try to connect it on there. And, you know, but that's going to take months, they say. So this gas is just leaking.
Just pouring. It's just filling the air.
And what's with the no-fly zone? It's so horrible that 30,000 feet in the air, people in an airtight tube can't go past at 600 miles an hour. Like, how bad?
No, because it's a weak spot now in America. Someone, if an enemy flies over there and drops some flammable, bye-bye California.
Oh, okay. Yeah, because you would need a commercial jetliner to get a spark. All you need is a good archer. That's all you need. A flaming arrow.
Hey, don't give anybody any ideas. I'm out here chilling.
Oh, we've had shows where we spend an hour just coming up with terrorism ideas. We did that as a bit one time because we were talking about the old hypocrisy of the airline security where you go. So they created these lines of like hundreds and hundreds of people. And we were just talking about like, why would you not just bomb the lines? Like that's even more people than a plane, you know, like let's just fucking, that's the new terrorism. That's what you do. And it turned into like an hour of us just,
though.
It turned into an hour that went into our FBI files. Oh. I'm sure
you get less versions if you look it that way.
That's great.
You get, what'd you say, David Box? You get less virgins.
I said you get less virgins if you do it that way.
Right, and that's what that's what we're all about here is minimizing the amount of virgins we have to deal with in heaven. That shit is a pain in the ass. Just give me two or three. What's wrong with you? That's all I want.
Could this gas leak really be a threat to national security? And is that why it's like blacked out in the media?
I guess.
Mm.
You know, here's what's kind of weird is, remember when the BP oil spill happened? There was news coverage of it every day.
They had the live stream of the oil yes. just coming out. Yeah, like here it is. There it is. Yeah. 25.
You guys want to watch the world burn?
25,000 gallons an hour. There you go, or whatever the number was. I don't remember, but
yeah,
there it is, just leaking out. And then people watched. There are YouTubers out there that watched that footage. I mean, they must have just been, you know, staying up for days. I mean, it was unbelievable.
It's like doing coke.
Dude, they would catch everything strange in the footage. After months and months have gone by of that synthetic Cynthia chemical being in the water, they're coming up with tons of these little things like, what is that? That's a weird anomaly right there. This is a thing right here. Check out this fucking fish that looks like a piano. What's that? You know, and like all these weird mutated little things flying around. Dude, that is an endless topic. So if you're listening to this show on YouTube, and if you're listening live, by the way, check out the Overdose Talk Show on YouTube. And you can see the past 100 episodes that we've done. And a bunch of clips and shit. So whatever. But if you're on YouTube, yeah, check out the Blue Plague and all that stuff. It is endless, man. There was a lot of weird stuff with that BP oil spill. And if this is worse, then I'm incredibly afraid.
We're going to need more golf balls.
Andrea, is this going to make global warming worse?
Yeah, this methane is just like drilling a hole through the ozone.
We need Bernie Sanders.
Yeah.
Save us from the methane, Gramps.
this is a Bernie campaign move.
I'm calling him Gramps from now on, by the way. It's kind of half insulting and half, you know, like just kind of good-natured joshing around.
We still love you.
Whatever. All right, AJ, it's been fun talking to you, but we got to keep moving here. So,
I shared a website on your page that has the dollar amounts and the gasoline amounts per hour.
You shared the website?
Yes, it's on your Overdose.
Yeah, I got
Facebook.
It.
Oh, it's on our Facebook. Okay, Andrea, throw that. The Overdose Talk Show on Facebook, where you can see we post about everything. Dude, thanks for coming on. I think we'll talk to you again hopefully soon. I'd like to keep up with some stuff and possibly collaborate on some of the anti-law enforcement, or as you might put it, maybe a little bit less militantly, you know, law enforcement reform, you might say. We'll keep in touch on all that stuff, and maybe we can work on something together with the show or something.
Sure, appreciate that.
All right, cool, man. Good luck to you. Yeah. We'll talk to you soon.
Bye. Yes,
all right, later.
So thanks, Andrea. Bye.
Bye-bye. All right, there goes old cousin AJ. Off into a California sunset. Off on
Can't
his,
you just imagine it?
Dude, there's no...
Methane gas.
There's no better feeling. Do you know what? He probably feels so good. There's no feeling better than being acquitted from a court case. I just had it recently. And it's fucking... Yeah, you're going to be high for a while. He's going to be all right, that kid.
Well, and he had a lot of people following what was happening with him, too. Imagine how satisfying it is for everybody involved, you know?
Yeah, it really is. It really is.
I feel satisfied.
We don't even know him, and he's our cousin.
That was the first time I ever talked to him.
How are we related to him, by the way?
I honestly don't know.
I have no idea.
He shares a last name with people in our family who live in Indiana.
Okay.
That's,
did you just find that out on Facebook, though? You don't even know who they are?
No, I'm not sure. They're on mom's side.
We just don't know our family at all.
No, you know who knows is Katie.
Katie keeps track of that shit?
Our sister Katie keeps track of everything. Yeah, I'll ask her later. We'll get to the bottom of this.
I don't know how we're related, but we're going to keep in touch from now on. We'll ask him.
We're sure glad we are.
We'll ask him next time. A government chemist tampered with 40,000 cases, locking countless innocent Americans in prison. Did you bring this?
Oh, yeah. Hell yeah.
What's going on with this lady?
She, first of all, she's got the worst eye of any person I've ever seen in my entire life.
Wait,
she's got
one of her eyes. Her name is Annie Dukin? Dukin?
Yeah.
Dukin?
Annie Dukin.
This seems very familiar. I thought we've done this before.
We may have.
Okay.
But her trial is occurring. But I actually got this to go in conjunction with another story. Let me find it. About police field tests as well. So basically this woman was faking drug results.
Right. Okay. We did do this on the show, but we'll just hit it again really quick. Yeah, she was basically getting kickbacks for positive drug tests, right?
Right, exactly.
Okay.
Annie
Dukin.
So now recently it's been...
She was a chemist doing the results of the test, just so we're clear.
Yeah, and it's been recently exposed that field drug test kits that police officers or police agencies use to test for drugs test positive for virtually anything you put in them. For instance, Tylenol PM tested positive for cocaine. Hershey's chocolate tested positive for marijuana.
Dude, those things are all screwy. I've fucking tested positive for PCP, and I don't think I've ever done PCP. I don't even really know what it looks like. I don't know how does it come? Do you get it in a fucking vial?
It's a powder, I think, isn't it? Angel dust?
Like in a gum wrapper, like heroin?
Yeah.
How do you even get it? I don't know, but I tested positive for PCP. I was smoking a lot of that synthetic marijuana that you get at the Indian gas station, and the guy like keeps it under the counter, and you're like, hey, you got K2? And he's like, looks around like, it's $10. I'm like, I don't think this is illegal, buddy. Like, yeah. Give me money. Like, all right. They do it like a drug deal, but it's totally legal. Those guys are hilarious. Yeah. But I was smoking a lot of that. I don't know. Whatever. My friend Jimmy took a drug test out in some strange county where he got arrested for selling acid to cops at a festival. And he ended up doing like 2 weeks in jail out in the country where they have those hippie festivals, you know? And so... He had drug tests out there in this place, and he one time, I guess he was gonna be dirty or whatever, and he just put tap water. He's like, I figured it was worth a try, you know. So he just put tap water in the thing and tried to get it at the right temperature and just put it in there and was like, yeah, it's clear. I've been drinking a lot of water, you know. And he tested positive for like 6 different drugs from the tap water. Yeah. It was prescription stuff. It was like stuff that was restricted, but they would find like codeine or like evidence of, you know, prescription painkillers. And then I think there was PCP in there too. So that's, you know, that's what's in the tap water apparently out in Will County.
That's disgusting.
Yeah, but the point is those things are fucking screwy.
Well, and these are like the little pouches that they use. They sprinkle your weed in and they say, oh, yeah, that's weed. They're like, they're not for your pee. They're for your stuff.
Back in my day, they used to just hold it up to the light like they were on Dragnet. Some strong. And they would always say something like, because that was when new weed, when really good weed first came out. I was like 16. And it was like everybody now had fucking this great weed, you know. The shit that everybody smokes now. That was new.
Yeah.
So you go, they would always go, this is some really potent stuff you got here. I'm like, what am I? I don't have a script. I don't know what I'm supposed to say to that. I know you're trying to set up some kind of cool little drug conversation, you know.
These are some dank buds.
Yeah, right. It's like, sure are, officer. They'd always try to make weird little jokes. Like, one time I was getting arrested and I had a pipe. And I don't know why I did this, but they were reading out loud what they were putting in the report. And they go, you know, and he had a red pipe or something. And like an idiot, I was like, it was a blue pipe, stupid. And this other cop goes,
yeah, of course he knows what color it was. It was probably a Christmas present.
And they all laughed. Like, what was that?
What?
That wasn't funny at all. Like, what? But they would always try to make jokes like that when you get arrested. And like, that wasn't a joke. And I swear to God, that was word for word what he said.
I found weed in your pocket. You like weed.
But you're like a real high guy.
Yeah. I'm the one who does drugs, huh? All right.
Yeah. Me dumb.
Me dumb. I on weed. Speaking of that, you've heard of have you been, David Box, have you seen the Marijuana Makes You Violent Facebook page?
Yeah, I love that thing.
Dude, that is the most hilarious shit. I don't think we've ever talked about it on the show, but they just constantly post things like that'll just be like 10,000 overdoses on marijuana this year. Like, when will it stop? And a picture of like a crying mother and just about different posts about marijuana making people murder their families, rape their pets, all kinds of shit. And then all these stoners comment on it like, don't you know that marijuana is the safest drug you can consume and alcohol? Yeah. And like, they leave all these serious replies. And then everybody else who's in on it, who are all of us are weed smokers, just leave them replies like, dude, you're so fucked up on weed, you don't have any idea what you're saying, you know, and you just try to get them to keep getting madder and madder. That's the whole point of the page, and I've wasted hours of my life doing that.
Yeah, here they've got the average weed addict's calendar, and one of the days on there is marked do road rage, and everything else is kill, rob, steal,
assassinate neighbors,
smother a tiny baby,
be a mean terrorist.
These are the things that marijuana make you do on a daily basis.
And they
shoot school bus with AK-47.
They have t-shirts that are like proud to be toke free, and then and then people buy them and wear them and post pictures to the page of them wearing them and looking like huge, like, loser nerds while they're wearing them. Like, it's just the weirdest, like, kind of backhanded form of humor I've ever seen. It's really funny.
Yeah, it's great.
For some reason, I was trying to pull up the page now, and I can't.
Moms on marijuana beat their children.
Yeah.
Dank abuse is domestic abuse.
I hope they...
And so many people take it seriously, too. They used to make more satirical and less blatantly ridiculous posts.
Yeah.
They've gone over the top a little bit, but it's so funny.
Yeah, it used to be harder to tell.
They say things like...
Yeah.
This is not a satirical page. We do not support bong tokens.
Right, people...
Meat is trash and dumb.
There's like, they'll post like, this is there's a lot of rumors going around that this is some kind of fake trolling page. This is not true. We do not support bong injecting hemp snorters or their psychotic friends. Let's do a quick break. I'm gonna go smoke. We'll be back in like 5 minutes on the Overdose Talk Show. Thanks for checking us out. Andrea and David Box.
Yeah.
You guys here?
We're here.
I think that music sounds good on vinyl, you two.
Do you think?
Yeah, I do. Dude, you know what happened today?
What?
All right. So, you know, I've been buying record collections because I sell on Amazon and eBay.
Yes.
And by the way, if you're in the New Orleans area and you want to unload your record collection, just send an email to SundayEveningOverdose @gmail.com. Or with anything else you want to tell us for the show, or if you want us to play your music during breaks, or any of that kind of shit, email SundayEveningOverdose@gmail.com, which is the old name of the show. We'll change that soon. Anyways, I'm trying to buy this record collection today. And I've been talking to this lady for a few days, and she's like, look, I just want to get these out of the house. You can pretty much have them for whatever you offer, which is great to hear. You know, I'm like, cool. She's like, well, here's the thing. I'm not going to be home from work until 10 o'clock, but my 16-year-old daughter will be there and can sell you the records. I have never talked to this. We've only texted. She's never heard my voice. All she has is an email address, and she's text messaged me. And she's like, yes, here, full-grown man that I've never met and know nothing about. Go to my home where I've told you I will not be until 10 p.m. and deal with my teenage daughter alone inside. So, of course, I'm picturing, like, Kelly Bundy immediately. I'm like, oh, my God, this is going to be some really hot little slut who's going to try to have sex with me. It was like my first thought. I was like,
naturally.
And how am I going to deal with this when this inevitably comes to be? What am I going to do? Oh no, you know? And but it struck me like, okay, I'm not a rapist murderer, but like, how do you know? You know, what kind of person just goes, yeah, you know, total stranger. Here's my address. She sends me the address. My 16-year-old daughter's home alone, and I won't be there till 10. It was 2
yeah,
o'clock.
Yeah, why is it?
It was 2 o'clock. Do you know what I could do in 8 hours? Jesus.
And why is that necessary? Couldn't she just say, I won't be home, period? You know,
or, hey, I might be home. Like, if why wouldn't you go, I might be there, I might not, I'm not sure when I'm gonna be home.
Yeah,
in case you're a rapist.
That's so creepy.
Yeah,
well, it's a good thing it was you and not a rapist murderer,
right? And it was just on Craigslist. It was just an ad I responded to on Craigslist, followed up by text messages. She just wasn't thinking. It's just poor decision making.
I'm afraid of everybody on Craigslist.
But she wasn't, she didn't look like Kelly Bundy, so it was all
no
right.
Kelly Bundy, huh?
Yeah, no.
Well, no problem then.
No, she...
You still banged her though, right?
She looked like a big, giant Louisiana pig. There was kind of, it was kind of a white trash area.
That's why she wasn't worried.
Yeah.
That's so funny that you said that, because that was what I was thinking driving away. I was like, oh, no wonder she wasn't worried about me raping her daughter. What a fucked up person I am. As I bought like 150 classic rock records for $30.
Yo.
Like, and all I'm thinking is like, bitch, you're lucky your daughter's ugly. A terrible piece of shit I am.
I wouldn't even meet someone on Craigslist by myself.
I've met people on Craigslist, sure, for all kinds of reasons. When I was like 22 to 24, maybe 25-ish, whatever, I was very interested in meeting older women on Craigslist, which is I can give you some strong advice, and I heard this on Playboy Radio a long time ago, and I should have heeded it. Sometimes a sexual fantasy is better left as a fantasy. Because when you're 22, you're not prepared for what's going on with a 45-year-old woman's body. You're just not. It's just not what you... Yeah, it's just not what you think it's going to be like. So, whatever. Anyways, have you heard of the Great Forgetting, Andrea?
Yeah, I have.
We talked on the last show, and it was funny. I just grabbed this because I thought it was a coincidence, or maybe not a coincidence, but a similar view. Is we talked about how being alive before the internet and then seeing the world completely taken over by the internet. We've lived through a very fast transition that could probably be compared to the agricultural revolution in terms of the effect it's going to have on the future of society and how it reshapes and how it develops. So I saw this article that basically made the same, didn't make the same comparison, but it talked about how the agricultural revolution was the beginning of something called the Great Forgetting, which was basically that's how they describe the loss of culture and knowledge of human tradition and really a knowledge of ourselves that we had before we were formed into societies and kind of given jobs and kind of started down this road towards what we know now, you know. And then I'm looking at this next transition as the end of that period, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I follow you.
Okay, but about 10,000 years ago, we came out of being wanderers and hunters and gatherers and said, okay, well, look, we can have mass food storage, and this guy can learn to play a lute. I don't think they had him yet, but this guy can bang on a fucking rock or whatever. We'll listen to that shit. And
hell yeah, we will.
Over here, this guy can make little, like, wood things that you put on a shelf. Holy what? Shit. You can have a house and just have a roll, and you know what I mean? So that's how it all changed. And the Great Forgetting refers to, like, we don't know, because written history started at that point. We didn't keep track of what we were before that. And part of the unnatural feelings that we all have and the kind of yearning for, you know, something a little more natural, I guess, than the society we're in might have a lot to do with the fact that we just don't have any memory of what makes us feel good and what we used to do ritualistically and, you know, in our early folklore and all that stuff.
Where we came from.
Yeah.
More deeply.
So what I'm thinking is, are we heading towards another Great Forgetting? Because you got shit right now where people go, man, look at all these kids that are like 20 and they never look up from their phones and they got no social skills. They can't deal with anything, blah, blah, blah. Well, okay, a couple generations, couple hundred years down the line, when people mostly have just been immersed in this age, is there going to be any memory that was abnormal and that was possibly a negative trait to have, is to not be social and to not engage in these things that we know now as traditional social behavior, especially if you're around 30 or older, you know?
Right. And
so are we headed toward that forgetting where people just go, well, what do you mean social? You know?
Yeah.
What the fuck are you talking about?
Social. Well, and there's also the issue of the compilation of information is expanding exponentially. You know, the amount of information that we have about what's happening right now versus the amount of information we had about what was happening even 100 years ago on a day-to-day basis, it outweighs all of human history already. Every hour, there are more pictures taken than in the first 100 years after the camera was invented.
So, right. So,
once an hour, 100 years worth of pictures are taken.
In 100 years, 99.999% of recorded history is going to be internet.
It will be having been started at the internet. Yeah.
Right. That's fucked up. And you see what I'm saying? Like, what did we forget then at the agricultural revolution? Yeah, that's right. Revolution. What did we forget then? Because you could see now, it's very easy to see how when, like, the value of social skills and face-to-face human interaction is completely lost, like, how scary of a thing that is. What would people before the agricultural revolution have said who were like we were talking about the other day? You know, internet came around for all of us when we were in teenage-ish years. You guys were a little younger. It's what would a pre-agricultural revolution person have said? Man, these fucking kids now, they don't know anything about dancing around in a circle wearing a fucking fox on your head. You know, they're all in their city, yeah, going to stores and markets and having jobs and stuff. Man, they don't know shit about fucking coyote howls. What's going on with these guys? What would they have felt like the loss was for humanity? Because you know they must have been like, man, I miss when we did this. Right at first, before they forgot.
Well, there is the aspect of assuming and expecting that tribes and cultures will be different than yours. You know, there was, I think when people lived on a more tribal basis, there was a large group of loyal people loyal to each other. And that whole group understood that other groups outside of their tribes were different and that they couldn't expect to influence them and make them come around to the way they do things.
And you think now we've got a thing where everyone's trying to force their beliefs on each other and make everyone like they are so we can all be comfortable together.
Someone has to be dominant. Something has been created where people have to control and they have to be dominant. And it's not enough to say, well, I'll do my thing and you do your thing.
Interesting, Andrea. I could see that.
So that's a pretty important thing to forget.
And that's what? Did you come up with that on your own or did you read that?
Well, I mean, I read about how the tribes would exist, you know, very isolated from each other, usually. And nobody really tried to dominate one another. It seemed like an easy line to draw.
Okay. Yeah. I guess, you know, this is a thing that was a theory that was developed through paleontology that made it clear that mankind had not arrived on planet Earth when civilization emerged, because people didn't really think about it for a long time. I guess nobody really thought about what were we like before we had, you know, streets and all this stuff. What were we doing? So it is a thing that just then all of a sudden we're unearthing bones and going, wait a second, we came from this? Yeah, who is this? What do they know that I should know?
And it's the same thing, you know, I think about this a lot with when we talk about like ancient Egypt or dead languages, like especially when there's a language that nobody knows how to speak anymore. When did it stop? You know, where's the line and how long has to pass before people totally forget about it?
Like,
and when is Latin going to go away?
Yeah, really. Who's still doing that? Lame.
But yeah, I feel a great forgetting is coming.
It must be, right?
I have a lot of stuff I'm gonna forget soon.
It has to be. Yeah, I have forgotten a lot of stuff. Somebody was telling me about a time that I like stood down some cops and like when I was 16. And had this big, long discussion in a 7-Eleven parking lot about the difference between morality and legality, which it amazes me how many times a police argument comes down to that. They literally don't understand the difference. And I have no recollection of it at all. I guess it was this big scene, and I was yelling at him and all this stuff. My great forgetting has been going for a long time. But yeah, we're going... So it's the interfacing with technology. And that's just where we're headed. And I don't know if there's any stopping it. We've talked before about how it seems irrational to fear progress in technology. Because it's going to happen. We want it for certain things. Even the most militant among us want modern convenience to a certain degree. And we want internet. We want it our way. We want it free. And we want it clean. And we want it untraceable, in, you know, for some of us. But we want it. Right? So we can't we can't just totally go, all right, we have to shut all this down. How do we preserve the things that we know are good about humanity in a coming age where people are going to naturally forget it if we let them, you know?
Yeah, I think the more pressing issue for me is the growth of technology means that probably humans overall will lose dominance in less time than people realize.
Oh yeah, the signs are everywhere.
As soon as robots can put it all, I mean, they've created everything for a robot revolution, except they haven't created all those things in one robot.
All the pieces are there, but Skynet has not become self-aware yet.
Yeah, exactly. They've got robots that can assemble themselves. They've got robots that can simulate emotion. They have robots that can make they know to human beings. They have robots that can run, sprint, jump. They have robots that can survive on organic material.
Ones that'll go into your bloodstream and stuff.
They have, oh my God, I just saw an origami robot that's literally a shapeshifter and can do, it can carry like 50 times its own weight, and it's like a shaped like a little teeny, teeny, tiny piece of paper, and it just shapeshifts into whatever it needs to do.
Well, we looked at that robot the other day that was able, you could say, hey, walk off that table, and it would go, no, I'll get hurt. So it was like able to process commands and go, no, that's not a good thing to do, and not do it. And that seemed really creepy, but then it struck me that's been around for many, many years, and probably the first form of it was maybe some kind of aviation thing or something that would override a thing that would make the plane fall out of the sky. You know, you can't just take this and go, boom, you know, a system will kick in and go, what are you, fucking stupid? You know. So that kind of intelligence has been around for years. We've been going this way for a long time. So instead of fearing it, that's what I keep coming back to. You know, instead of just fearing it, we're talking about an incredible level of vigilance we need to get to as like consumers and watchdogs. You know what I mean? This is the thing. The world is impossible at this point. We're just descending into evil everywhere, and there's nothing you can do because, like, we would literally have to all galvanize on one fucking problem at a time, and everyone in the world drop what they're doing and go, okay, let's solve this one. Let's get the technology. Let's figure out, first, all right, robots. Let's find out who's making these fucking things, who's their entire lineage and their culture and who's at the CEO and at the head and making the real decisions and figure out if he's a good or a bad, like, how are we ever supposed to police this stuff? You know what I'm saying? The insane vigilance that it would take to really control like the advance of this technology and make sure it's working for the betterment of humanity. It's fucking impossible. We're just going to get taken over by something. If it's not just the physical government takeover, it's going to be robots. We're fucking screwed here.
Yeah, something is taking over. There's no getting around that. But this technology is throwing off so much radiation that we'll probably just all be dead by then anyway, so.
Yeah, we're going to die and the robots are going to just, like, ease in.
They're just going to eat our corpses.
It's not going to be them killing us. It's smooth transition.
No, they'll scavenge us.
They're going to be getting all ready to have the robot revolution. Like, holy shit. You know what? Let's just wait 6 or 7 months. I think we're going to have a cakewalk here, boys.
Yeah. Hypersleep.
Oh, shit.
Oh, man.
What is this? Well, sorry. Go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to mention the laws of robotics, but that's okay. We can go ahead.
No, what are the laws of robotics?
Well, according to Isaac Asimov, the laws of robotics are that a robot may not injure a human being or, through an action, allow a human being to come to harm. A robot must obey the orders given to him by human beings, except where such orders would conflict with the first law.
Is this iRobot stuff?
Yeah.
Okay.
But it's applicable here. And a robot must protect its own existence as long as such protection does not conflict with the first or second laws. So a robot that can make decisions on its own, these seem airtight, but they're not, as we know from iRobot. Did you ever see that?
No.
The robots get around these rules basically by peacefully detaining all human beings and putting them in protection pods.
I'm pretty sure we did this exact same thing on the last show.
It drives me crazy. I can't stop thinking about it because I know it's going to happen to us.
Yeah, because the robots decided that our job is to keep people safe, and the best way to keep them safe is to put them all in these little pod cells to make sure nobody can get them. We'll just fucking pump some food in, and they'll be fine.
Yeah.
No, it wasn't just that. It was like these idiots are going to kill themselves.
Oh, okay. Like,
you know, it's... Yeah.
There's always the sanctimonious thing with robots. No, you guys are using nuclear weapons on your own planet, and war is so senseless, and the pursuit of material gain, and blah, blah, blah. Robots and their bullshit, sanctimonious garbage. Sick
their
of them.
Holier-than-thou attitudes.
No shit.
Like, they think they're so great. They don't want us to care about material goods. They are material goods.
Right? Yeah, you are material goods, you fucking piece of metal shit. And wait till robots develop religion. That's going to be the most annoying thing.
Oh, yeah. That's perfect. That's just what we need.
Wait till they want to marry humans.
Yeah, well, David Box, we're never going to stand for that in my family.
No, we're taking a stand right now.
Although you are about you're about as robotic as a person could be and marry someone in our family, I think. I think you've gotten as yeah, I think you're as close as it's going to come. You've got a very even robotic vibe sometimes, David Box, you know that.
Yeah, well, I'm consistent.
Yes. That's what everybody says about you. Man, I wish David Box was here. He's so consistent.
He sure is always the same. Yeah, you do. You're the most stable person in our family, I'd say.
Andrea and David Box are getting married for anyone who's new to the show.
Yeah, she's my fiance.
He engaged
whatever.
Me.
What's this, what's this California government forcibly sterilized Latina women without their consent article all about? California government forcibly sterilized Latina women without their consent.
How do you do that? I've been working on that forever.
Blog .heart.org gets the credit on this. Disturbing revelations about a U.S. government program to forcibly sterilize Latina women are now emerging, and the evidence is more damning than previously thought. The documentary No Mas Babies compiled... why is that funny? Compiled a litany of evidence that sheds light on one of California's most disturbing secrets, one reminiscent of Nazi eugenics programs. The state sanctioned the forced sterilization of Latina women. Andrea.
Again with the Nazi bashing.
Andrea, how do you feel about this as a woman? I know, David Box, by the way, I'm sorry, I've rolled right over that. You're right. We do know the Nazis have gotten a really fucking bad rap. And you know, enough is enough.
Why don't they mention the Bill Gates eugenics program?
That weird TED conference thing he did.
Yeah.
That's more relevant. We need to reduce the population in third world countries because too many people there are dying. And
so if there's less people can die.
Yeah, and the overpopulation happens because of the high death rates, people have more kids. To combat the high infant death rates, and then not as many die, and there's too many kids. So, if we give them GMO corn and vaccines, then they won't be so afraid, and they'll have 2.3 kids like they're supposed to, and we can get those darkies under control. Everybody with me? Oh no. His fucking PR team is behind the curtain. Did he say darky? I don't know. I wasn't listening. Fuck. No. Tell me he did not say darky. But that's what I felt like. It was so fucking... It was such a weird, twisted, like, patronizing look at, like, third world countries that he had. That it would. I felt like he was about to reveal himself at any moment.
Yeah. His skin was going to peel back.
Yeah, give them vaccines so they're not so afraid that their kids will die. Then they'll have less kids. And we'll all be fine.
Problem solved.
Yeah.
No one will starve ever again.
But they're having the kids because too many of them are dying.
He just wanted to do smart guy charity stuff.
Right. He was just
big smart guy charity stuff. And what's bigger than Africa?
Quick, whip me up a PowerPoint on killing Africans, but make it look like an accident.
Yeah. Don't let nobody know.
Yeah, that was a creepy thing he did. But whatever. Anyways.
So, this program ran for 54 years, 1909 to 1963. where over 20,000 Californian Latina women were sterilized after birth. Like, they would go into a doctor, they would give birth, and then immediately afterwards, the doctor would tie their tubes and then tell them after that, hey, just so you know, I did this to you.
And they would be like, oh, Dios mío.
Yeah.
And he'd be like, get out of here, you stupid Mexican.
Mexican.
How would they say it? How would they say it in 1950? You Mexican.
Yeah. That's, and for some reason, the doctor, I'm imagining the doctor dressed as like a soda jerk.
Right, yeah. And then after the operation, he just walked back behind the fucking cash register.
Yeah, and pressed one button and it was just like, bing!
Sell a pack of Lucky Strikes to an 8-year-old.
Yeah. Now you bring those on to your pappy, boy.
It must feel bad, kind of like for the teenage Latina moms who didn't want to have the kid. After they have the kid, the doctor's like, well, now your tubes are tied.
Right. Shit, and I was thinking about aborting this kid and having the next one. I had a feeling this one was going to turn out fat.
Yeah. Who needs them?
Right. What they said, 20,000 California Latina women were forced sterilized. That is so fucked up.
Yeah, that's incredibly fucked up.
Dude, they used to just do shit to people. Like, I'm sure it still goes on somewhere, but at one time, they didn't even hide it. It would just be, you know, because the spread of information was so slow that they didn't even really have to worry about containing, you know, things like that. Even if it got leaked a little bit somewhere, whatever. Oh, if one magazine had the balls or a newspaper to run with it, big fucking deal. What are you going to do? The Tuskegee experiments, you know about that, mm-hmm. right? They just gave syphilis to a shitload of dudes. You know, I mean, they just do this stuff to people. This was just standard operating procedure.
Yeah, and the people in California who did know about it, most of them saw it as legitimate population control.
Yeah, well, people get sold on that overpopulation thing really easily. It amazes me how fucking sold people are on that have never done any research on their own, have no idea what they're talking about, no idea the abundance of resources that are available on this planet. They're being hoarded by fucking elite classes as they've been doing for thousands of years, and just go casually, well, you know, the world is overpopulated, so you're irresponsible if you have a baby anyway. Shut up, you fucking idiot. Just people that they really buy into that so easily.
That's overpopulation.
So I guess they've always been that way, huh? Population control. That had more to do with traffic, though, in California in the 50s.
Yeah. Oh.
It did. Yeah, I'm sure. It was just, it's fucking crowded out here.
All right, wait.
We didn't build this right.
Here's what else they have, too. They also leaned on the welfare excuse, saying that sterilization of immigrants was necessary to keep welfare expenditures to a minimum. That was over 100 years ago. Dude, they were using that excuse.
If a candidate in an election or anybody came out and made a public statement that was like anything, even like a slight faux pas about welfare or this now, you know, they'd be crucified. And at that time, the average person was just like, oh, you got to force sterilize Mexicans to fucking keep welfare down? Yeah. Yeah, that's good. I am on board. You got my vote.
Yeah, whatever you need to do, guy.
Seems
to know what you're talking about.
But can you imagine the difference between then and now, though? Seriously?
Yeah.
People actually were like, well, no, that seems legitimate.
Yeah, is it that much weirder that, like, people got behind Trump when he said, I think Muslims should all wear badges so that we know that they're Muslims?
He just says whatever's going to get him attention.
Yeah, but it's all, like, people, there are people in the country who still align with that.
Or who knows what that lunatic actually thinks? Who the fuck knows? But I keep
saying... No, and it's not about what he thinks. It's about what everybody else thinks who's supporting him. Because those people are real people.
Sure.
And that's what's scary. I mean, he can say the fucked upest, weirdest, most racist thing, and people will still stand behind him.
I'm glad you said that, Andrea. What has he said that's been racist?
Well, okay. Let me rephrase. Here's the thing.
And I'm not a Trump supporter. I'm not an anyone supporter for president. I'm in support of not having a president anymore. I don't give a fuck. But I'm a language supporter, and I hate to see language distorted and you know, perverted. And I keep seeing people call him racist, and I don't understand why, because I think they're referring to the Mexicans and the Muslims comments, neither of which are races, so I don't understand the racist comment. This is me being a stickler.
Yeah, I used that to generalize how most people refer to what Trump says and what he believes.
No, it's fine, but
I understand that it's not that those two groups of people are not racist.
Right.
But what is the word that you put in the headline that replaces racist that has the same meaning for religion?
A lot of people are going xenophobes now.
Okay.
He might be a xenophobe, but it's not. I mean, here's the thing.
Is that broad enough?
That whole thing got so blown out of weird proportion, too. He said, we need to stop immigration. And they would always cut the clip. And what he actually said is, we need to stop immigration for right now until we can figure out who exactly we're bringing in the country and what's going on here. You know, and then he later amended it and said, like, no, of course, like, you know, people who are established, you know, this or that, and they need to fly back and forth, we wouldn't restrict that or whatever. So it was like, again, not a fucking fan of the guy, but he gets crucified for weird reasons, you know,
where he's but he also gets glorified for the same reasons by the other half of people.
Yeah. I always forget that this is a whole country of 6-year-olds.
Yeah. I mean, like, those people are out there, and that's just the point I'm making. Whether or not Trump has anything genuine about the way he is, there are real people who are eating it.
No, I know. And like I say, I don't give a shit who becomes the president up to a certain extent. I don't see how it could get much worse than it's been for my whole lifetime. You know, it's been a complete joke. You know, I don't see where it's going to get worse. You know, so I don't care. I'd rather work towards, you know, dissolving the entire fucking thing. So whatever, put whoever you want in there. However, Trump, yeah, like I've said, I've been on the fence about, is he part of the illusion? Is he playing a role? Is he part of an elite setup? Or is he legitimate and, you know, they're trying to demonize him? I really can't make up my mind on it.
I think based on the amount of media coverage he's getting, he probably has his hand in a pot or two at the top. I have a feeling he stands to gain something, win or lose.
Yeah, because maybe if they really feared him, they'd treat him like they treated Ron Paul, where they were like,
yeah,
basically, dude, I remember the debates that Ron Paul was in when they would cut to commercial every time it was his turn to talk. It was blatant. It was unbelievable. They feared him.
Yeah.
They knew he could get real support, you know?
Well, and that's the same thing to a certain extent is happening to Bernie Sanders, too, to the point where he's even come out and been like, hey, you assholes are giving Hillary more time than me. You're covering her shit more than I am. You're skewing everything in her favor, and I'm sick of it, and I'm not going to let you push me around.
Right. And again, we're not Bernie fans, but the dude has been railroaded out of the media to a large extent. Like, he was a giant fucking national celebrity before he was mentioned at all on mainstream media. You know, they'd throw in a little thing, oh, and a guy from Vermont is going to do something, whatever, who cares. But Hillary, you know, and he was, everyone, they forced him, social media forced him basically into the spotlight, in major media. And I might be naive there. I might be falling for the whole thing. I could
it's a grassroots thing.
Well, yeah, and I might be naive to buy that, but that's what it looked like to me. I saw him being, you know, basically hidden in media, and but the average person walking around seems to love him.
Yeah. But
who cares? It's all a bunch of bullshit, childish nonsense, you know?
Yeah. None of it's real. It doesn't matter.
Yeah. It's fucking... It's fine. That little thing he did at the last debate. It's, you know, I could be wrong, but it seems to me that any one of the choices up here on this stage would be better than those conservative wackos. All right. You're just playing the game, Gramps.
You elect me president, it'd be pretty, pretty, pretty good.
No, you did it way better than he did it when he did the lyric.
Pretty
good. An idiot.
Pretty good.
I tried to do the Larry David impression. Ugh. Yuck, Gramps. Stop.
Bernie Sanders.
Stop embarrassing. If I was one of Bernie Sanders' college age supporters, here's what my bumper sticker would say: Stop embarrassing us, Gramps. That's what it would say. And it would say Bernie Sanders, 2016.
Mine would say Grandpa President. No, President Grandpa. Grandpa President.
He just literally had to just come out and say a few of the right things, and he got the support of so many young liberals as just such a Gramps. That's what he is.
Dude, Obama did the same thing.
Yeah.
Obama had done even less when he came up as a presidential candidate.
But he was able to pull
up. And he had that same, like, swooping, like, whirlwind of excitement around him.
He did, but he was able to pull off the young thing.
He smoked a Newport one time.
And he was black. And, you know, black people be aging well. And that is true. Like, you see, like... You see, like, 50-year-old black guys that you think are, like, 28. No, they're 50.
Yeah. How old are you?
They age really well. One time, I say that, though, because the original host of the show, who went by the name of the Earthling, he had a little pizza job. And I was hanging out at his job one day, and this black guy, who I guess was, like, probably in his 50s, and what turned out to be his daughter, you know, were ordering pizza. And Trick said something like, "Do you want something for you and your wife or whatever?" And he goes, "That's my daughter." And Trick just stops. His name's the Earthling. Sorry. And he goes, "Oh, sorry. You know, y'all peoples be aging well." And I was like, "Why'd you say that?"
Very nice compliment.
I know. That's what I said after they left. I was like, "Why did you say that? That was such a weird thing to say." And he's like, "Oh, what is somebody going to get mad? You're saying my people age well and we look younger than we are? That's racist." Yeah.
Positive racism.
Right. So that's why I always say that. Y'all people be aging well.
Yeah, no. Okay, fine. So, yeah, Obama did have a little bit of the youthful thing, but he didn't have as much of the... he had less extreme alternative views. Bernie Sanders could be considered somewhat extreme by many people's standards that high up on the ladder. And I think that's where he makes up for the age.
Yeah, I guess. Because he goes... oh yeah, we need to end the war on drugs. That's why I'm making marijuana legal. What?
Oh yeah, yeah. We talked about that.
Yeah.
Well, it's the worst drug of all. You know, they arrest the most people for that.
Real fresh pops.
That makes it the worst.
Yeah. Oh my god. You know all those.
I looked at the polling numbers.
Yeah.
It seems most of my supporters smoke marijuana. So I'll legalize it.
So I'm in support of it. And then watch Obama pull the same.
I may be wrong, but I think this is going to work.
Obama pulled the same shit, like, yeah, marijuana should absolutely be legal. And then when he gets in office, like, eh, it's not realistic.
What's GMOs should absolutely be labeled.
Yeah. David Box seemed like he was trying to get one in.
He, I don't know what he has said about other drugs, but I know that he talks about the war on drugs from the addiction angle. And he, like, talks about how addiction is a disease and needs to be treated. And then he brings it into the whole how many people we have in prison. You know, it's like all of these speakers, they, like, can't focus on one thing and they talk about a zillion. But, like, he also says that about the war on drugs, is that there should be a different approach that's more treatment instead of incarceration.
Right. No, and that's good. I agree. But if you're not in support of full legalization, you're just not paying attention, you know? And it makes me suspicious. Like, if you're that smart of a guy and you know how to play a lot of these games and you can get that far in politics, I have a hard time believing that you actually think the best thing for society is for drugs to remain illegal. And the best thing for Mexican society, by the way. Fucking know what it's doing to their country? You know what I mean? Like, this is... It's unbelievable to me. I literally don't believe that you think that as an intelligent person. You know what I mean?
I hope I don't sound like I'm just defending him, but, like... to play devil's advocate, it's not an electable stance to take to say that you're just going to legalize all drugs.
That's what I mean, and that's why he's not the fresh new. Hey, this is the honest thing. This is Bernie said. Like, no, he's a politician. If he's an intelligent guy, then he knows that drugs should be legal. See what I'm saying? This is the thing where I go, like, you're full of shit. You're full of shit, Gramps. You got logs all up in your Depends. You got old fucking
old Grampy poop pants.
Old thin fucking pinched off colon logs in your pants.
Why?
Because he's old and constipated.
Oh.
Full of shit, this guy. You see what I'm saying?
Completely full of shit.
You pick him apart, dude. You pick him apart. Because you can play the sound bites. This guy is a fucking master of sound bites. You play the sound bites and you go, not much to disagree with, right? But you just pick him apart and he's this fucking same shit. Have fun electing him if you want. That fucking, that thing that's never wrong, that college, whatever it is,
Western Illinois University.
Yeah, has predicted every president since 1970. They say he's going to be there. All right. Everybody have a good time. I hope you enjoyed the last 8 years where everything changed so much. Man, are things better. Yeah. Woo-wee. Boy, oh boy. God, has there been so much progress.
Having a black president was fun.
Yeah. It's been awesome, everybody. So have fun with this guy. Have fun. Is he Jewish? He's got to be.
His grandparents, one of his grandparents was Jewish.
He's playing a Jewish character then.
Yeah.
He's trying to sound Jewish, at least, if he's not. I don't know. Have fun with the Jewish president. Give a fuck. Gives a shit.
If he gets elected, at least we'll be able to say that the voting people didn't want Trump. And I feel like that's sort of a good thing to feel.
I would almost be a little bit more heartened to see people vote for Trump because he's the real fuck you guy of the whole thing. He's the real just like, you know what? I don't give a shit. Everybody in this country is an asshole. I'm not fucking playing around. I know how to get shit done.
And I say what I want.
Yeah, and like that is something I admire a little bit more than wanting to make pot legal. Like Trump, I'm sure, he has such an understanding of business and economics. He knows about the drug trade. I'm sure he fucking knows people that have been involved in laundering money for major cartels, because you know that's a huge business, right? You understand that, like, a lot of people who are really successful in banking and investment and stuff, they're intimately familiar with with the way that Mexico and the Mexican cartels launder their money. And it goes through European banks. And there's a lot of people involved. There is a lot of fucking people involved. And a lot of really wealthy people involved. And Trump, I guarantee you, he knows all about this shit. He knows all fucking about it. And the reason he's not saying legalize drugs is because he wants to get elected. So whatever. It's the same thing. He knows the same shit as Bernie Sanders knows, as whatever. And I just like the fuck you guy a little better. It's like the guy that I feel like might actually be entertaining.
There might be one.
Because in the end, it does not matter. The president goes back and forth. The Congress goes back and forth. Hey, Clinton couldn't get anything done with that Republican Congress. Bush couldn't get anything done with that Democratic Congress. Oh, boo-hoo. Man, isn't it a shame that we set this system up and it doesn't work? Okay, reload, try again. No, suck my dick. Fuck you. I'm done with
it. I'm going to vote for a third party candidate. Yeah.
No, I'm done with it. No third party. No, fuck all your shit. I don't recognize your authority over me. How about that? You enforce it through threat of violence. Good for you. I don't care about your stupid president. Fuck off. Don't recognize his authority or any of the rest of it. It's immaterial and it means nothing to me. There we go.
I really liked, you posted something recently about, it was like a guy at a party and he comes out of, was this you? Maybe it wasn't you. He comes out, it's a guy at a party and he comes out into a room.
Yeah,
and
I know what you're talking about. That was me. Yeah. And he goes, hey, you guys ordered pizza? Like,
go ahead.
No, oh, I was trying to flow with you a little bit there. Yeah, they're like, he's like, you guys ordered pizza? And they're like, yeah, we ordered pizza while you were in the bathroom. Now you owe us $5. And he's like, well, I didn't even want pizza. Well, by being at the party, you implicitly agreed to pay for pizza. So give us your $5 or we're going to lock you in the closet. This is a great little analogy for income tax, I guess.
Yeah, or I also saw it as an analogy for voting too. Like I didn't design the system. I never agreed to be part of the system.
No, you forced it upon me only through threat of violence, and that's all you've ever used to make me respect your system.
And then you're going to say it's my fault that it sucks.
Right. And as an intellectual person and as a free human being on this planet, I don't recognize your authority. That's different. See, you can enforce it through violence and threat thereof, right? But that hasn't won anything from me. That hasn't won a single fucking bit of my soul or intellect, right? So that's the battle. I don't recognize you. That's the whole game. If we could all get there, we'd all look up and go, man, what a silly bunch of little weirdos that have been manipulating and controlling us for so long. Man, I wish we would have realized sooner that this was all just a fucking switch that you flip in your mind. I don't recognize your authority or power. You can force it onto me, but I do not recognize it as legitimate. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, I'm with you 100%. It's not something people are receptive to, though.
Well, a lot of people have probably not been in... A lot of people haven't been through as much with the system as I have, too.
Right.
And been, you know... It had affected me from a really young age. For victimless crimes, you know, you start out with just weed and stuff, you know what I mean? And it's like, and then you just get indoctrinated into a criminal lifestyle because that's what the formula is. That's what they want. They want you to be a perpetual, a perpetual contributor to the whole revolving door law enforcement thing that goes on where you just, hey, oh, you did it again, $2,000 to us. and you got to do all this work. You're going to come in and do free work for us that we fucking contract out to other people and make money for the state as a slave laborer. You know what I mean? Like,
or you're going to pay us more money.
Or you're going to go to jail, motherfucker. And so, yeah, so it's, I think people aren't receptive to it who haven't been firsthand affected by it. But like, if you know, once you know the evil of government in general and our, especially our current system, it's just, it's undeniable, and it just flips that switch in your head and you go, wow, I am not the bad one. I know I've got a rap sheet a fucking mile long, but I am not the bad one in this situation.
Finally.
I can guarantee you. And you just gotta realize that at some point that they, yeah, it's all just it's a clever trick. Power is a clever trick of the mind. If you don't agree that someone has power, they don't have power.
Yeah, that's all there is to it.
It's all balancing very, very precariously, you know, for the establishment. And it always has been, will be as long as it goes on for, which hopefully isn't too much longer. Because, boy, am I getting exhausted. Getting real sick of this old tyranny thing.
The same old song and dance, day in, day out.
Really? Shit's been going on since Charlemagne.
I do want to let everybody know that I couldn't corroborate the story about the FBI heading out to Oregon.
Yeah, we got anything? That's fucking, that's breaking news that's going on now, pretty much. And I have no idea what to expect from that whole situation in Oregon with the militia taking over that cabin. The federal building, the people on the left and their whole stupid fucking thing, dude. There's armed militants taking over a federal building. It's a cabin. Then no one was there. Not one soul was there.
Yeah.
I agree that from your perspective as like a TV watching average person in this country, you go, holy fuck, I have no frame of reference for this. Just guys with guns took something over and that looks scary. Yes. Do a little reading. Figure it out.
You'll be okay.
Yes. Figure it out. These people, it's easy to go, well, the militias, all they ever do is claim they're being persecuted and just look for any way and even try to force the government to act against them so they can have an excuse to just go crazy. Dude, come on. They're humans like you. There is a reason that they feel the way that they feel. You gotta fucking understand, even if you hate people like this, and look, I don't want to hang out with these people, probably. They seem like a bunch of fucking nerds, like the kids that would have a compass, you know, when you'd be hanging out when you're a kid, and they'd be like, well, don't worry, guys, I've got my compass. You'd be like, oh, shut the fuck up with your stupid compass. They grew up to be these guys, and that's so okay, so whatever, but look at it for what it really is. They're human beings with perspectives and culture that once it's a little bit more understood, if you're a person on the left who just hates this kind of shit, just fucking make a little effort to understand where they're coming from. And this does not seem so crazy whatsoever.
Yeah, when you really break it down step by step, it seems like kind of a logical progression.
Yeah.
I don't know if I would ever get to that point.
Neither.
But I don't have a gun, so it's hard for me to say.
No, I know that I would. I mean, everybody has their own line. For me, it's pretty much I'm going to ride this out until it gets to be physically dangerous to be a free person. Like if they're like you know, something like, "Hey, there's a forced vaccination going on, or there's a fucking you're getting a chip implanted, or it's time to get a tattoo, or it's time to go to a camp," then I'm kicking and fighting my way out, hopefully, or going down blazing. I'm not, like, that's in my genetics for whatever reason. I've always felt that way. I will fight the government at some point. Who knows when? But it's in me. I'll do it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like you've definitely. Been waiting for it your whole life.
No, I do.
Like maybe you should go out and provoke the government.
Yeah. No, in fact, it's horrifying and I hate it. But I know that I'm capable of it and that my morals will prevent me from cowering. You know, that like I know that when the time comes, if forces are, you know, storming down the streets and it's Nazi Germany shit, dude, fuck no. I'm going out in a blaze, you know, and that's easy to say. So, you know, don't believe me, do believe me, whatever. I know it in my heart, unless they just bust in my door and I'm like eating cereal. I'm like, uh oh, did not see this coming. Well, I guess I'll put my hands up.
Whoops, a doodle.
Yeah, just like. Yeah, I'm saying if things go right.
All right, guys, you got me.
I'm saying if things go right and I got, a, like, you know, 12 or 15 other people that are cool with it and we all got guns, then we're talking. Some real fighting. Yeah.
You can invade a cabin.
Mm-hmm. No, but yeah. No, really, you don't think you would flee, fight back? You think you would, you'd go down like a wimp? In a total takeover?
I feel like I would hear the commotion before anyone got to me and I'd slip away.
Well, and
I feel like that's what we would do.
Yeah, we would probably slip away.
Being well informed and in tune to conspiracy stuff, we would know before everyone else. Like, we would know. We'd have a weak jump on things. We would know when it was a serious fucking, the takeover was going to happen, and we'd take to the rivers and we'd get our infrared blocking, like, blankets and everything, you know? And just float down the river till we get to Mexico.
Yeah.
Yep.
Mexico sounds like the freest place to go.
I like how David Box just wakes up every 20 minutes and says one thing.
That's how I am, you know.
That's how I am, you know.
I like to take it in.
Hey, the show's over.
Oh, goodbye.
Okay. Bye. Well, thank you, Andrea and David Box. Thanks to our cousin AJ. Andrea, what was his shit for people to check out again?
In League Press. I shared it on our Facebook page. I'll link it in the YouTube video.
What was
in
the other one?
Press.
Anaheim James.
Yeah, Google Anaheim James. I did it earlier. He's got some cool stuff on there.
Cool.
He's made a real impact on the internet. So,
all right, check that out. And if you're new to the show, don't forget to subscribe and share us with all your little pals out there in YouTube land. This has been the Overdose Talk Show. Thank you very much. Goodbye.
Bye.